بسم الله. يا yeah, we still with Qiyas last time, we didn't finish what the thing I was talking about. Inshallah, I just finished the point that I was talking about last time, and then I know that you have been asking other people, and they told you definitely their objections. So I would like to hear it. Probably we will have an answer for it. Yeah, last time. Of course, we said that nobody has been able until today to bring from Quran and Sunnah proof, like a clear that Allah ordered us or gave us permission to do qiyas. You won't find it. It's not in the Quran, it's not in the Sunnah. They rather go to the Prophet used to do qiyas and bring some examples, which alhamdulillah, when you look at it, the Prophet never done any qiyas. And then they come and say, okay, if you don't do qiyas, mostly this, if you don't do qiyas, what are you going to do with this? And they give you examples. One of these examples that we were discussing last time, and this is considered to be one of their strongest arguments. For example, they say that is the where we stopped last time. Like Ibn Kathir said in his tafsir, he said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, قُلْ لَا أَجِدُ فِيمَا أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ مُحَرَّمًا عَلَى طَاعِمٍ يَطْعَمُهُ إِلَّا أَنْ يَكُونَ مَيْتَةً أَوْ دَمًا مَسْفُوحًا أَوْ لَحْمَ خِنْزِيرٍ فَإِنَّهُ رِجْسٌ أَوْ فِسْقًا أُهِلَّ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ بِهِ. Meaning that say that I don't find in what Allah say, I find not in the message received by me by inspiration any forbidden anything to be forbidden to be eaten by one who wishes to eat it, except unless it be dead meat or blood poured forth or flesh of swine, for it is an abomination. The flesh of swine, for because it is an abomination. They say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said here, the flesh of swine, the flesh of swine is an abomination. And he said that the flesh of swine is haram. So, if you are, since you are someone who doesn't do qiyas, are you going to eat fat? Because he didn't mention fat here. He mentioned the flesh of swine. The answer for that is, we have to go to the Arabic words first, to the Arabic language. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the flesh of swine, because it is an abomination or a pure impure. What is impure? The flesh of a swine or the swine?
The swine.
The swine. Because according to the Arabic language, it, which is
colon.
Return to the nearest mentioned word. That is the swine. Ibn Kathir tried to deny that. He said that the it here, it goes back to the flesh. And there is a saying about Arabic that there. Some opinion in the Arabic language, they say it will go to the mudaf rather than the mudaf ilayh. But that is wrong. The majority of the Arabic language scholars, don't agree with that. And Ibn Kathir himself doesn't agree with that. Because if you go to Surah, for example, Surah An-Nahl and many other surah, I just give you an example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَتَى أَمْرُ اللَّهِ فَلَا تَسْتَعْجِلُوهُ. أَمْرُ اللَّهِ, the order of Allah has came. Don't hasten it or him. فَلَا تَسْتَعْجِلُوهُ, the Arabic ha, the damir. So here it goes back to Amr or Allah. Ibn Kathir say, yeah, it goes to Allah. So he agree here that it goes to the nearest mentioned rather than, so he contradicted himself here, there, when he said that, he was just talking, trying to defend him, his madhab. And we go back to give him another example, because since they rely on the Sahaba, Sahaba do qiyas, and the Sahaba understand better, there is a hadith in Muslim where the Prophet said, the Prophet made a speech in Eid day and said, whoever has no one should eat, should eat meat from the meat of the sacrifice. No one should eat from the meat of the sacrifice more than 3 days. This speech, the Prophet has done this speech on Eid day. The following year, the Sahaba started melting fat from their sacrifices and put it in their hides, storing it. The Prophet heard of it and he said, why are they doing this? They said, you have forbidden eating the flesh of the meat, of the sacrifice. So they are storing the fat. You see here, if they say, when you say, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forbidden the flesh of the swine, meaning he has forbidden everything. Only a stupid person will think that there is difference between the flesh and the fat. Well, this is what the Sahaba have understood, and the Prophet never said anything about it, except that you shouldn't, that except he said, no, I have forbidden the flesh of the meat that year because there was hunger. So now you can eat and store and give in charity. So the understanding of the Sahaba goes against the understanding of the people who do qiyas. And since they say this is an understanding, everybody who is in his full mind, anybody who is not stupid, when you tell him the flesh of swine is forbidden, he will understand that the fat is forbidden and the milk is forbidden and the skin is forbidden. Okay, let's say, read another ayah in Quran. After that ayah that Allah mentioned about the flesh of the swine being forbidden, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ هَادُوا, and those who followed the Jewish law, we forbade every animal with undivided hoof. And we forbade them the fat of the ox. He forbade them the fat of the ox and the sheep. The fat of the ox and the sheep, Allah has forbidden it for the Jewish people. Everybody agree that Bani Israel, the Jewish, are allowed to eat the meat of the ox and the sheep. Nobody say that when Allah has forbidden the fat, they should have made the flesh haram as well. Because this is what they say. What's the difference between flesh and the fat? Anybody who is in his mind understands that the flesh and the are similar. Allah has forbidden one, second one should be forbidden. And then we go to the Hanbalis. Just because the majority go against the hadith, there is a hadith that says that you should do wudu from the flesh, from eating the flesh of the camel. There is hadith that says you have to do wudu from eating the flesh of the camel. They have said there is no difference between the flesh and the fat and the milk. They say the flesh of the swine and the fat of the swine and the skin of the swine and the milk of the swine became haram by qiyas. When Allah said the flesh of the swine is haram. Okay, the Prophet said do wudu from the flesh of a camel. You eat the flesh of camel, you do wudu. The Hanbalis say you don't have to do wudu from the milk of the camel. So if you consider the milk of a swine being haram by qiyas, why don't you do qiyas here as well? You have to do wudu from the milk of the... Here you see the contradictions. So this is the example I was talking about last time. And if either there is anyone who want to give an example, or because I heard that you had some examples, some people have been, and it's good to go and make researches really. So if anyone has, before I continue, yes.
There is a hadith the Prophet mentions. He says, if a mice goes in your sandwich.
If sandwich?
In your,
In the butter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You should take off the...
The mice, if he's dead.
Yeah.
When they ask him about mice, which is dead, that has fallen into butter, and then it's dead. And he said, "Ulquhu wa ma hawlaha." Throw him, throw it, and what is around it. Just you have to take a scoop. What is around the minimum, and throw it away. Yeah, and then the zahir is here. Depends on the zahir is. Ibn Hazm here say the mice in the butter. So if a cat falls in anything else rather than the butter, it's fine and it's dead. Or the majority say any animal dead in any liquid. This is what you want to say.
I want to say if another creature goes inside your sandwich,
yes.
You eat it.
No, it's not sandwich, the butter.
Yeah, the butter.
Yeah. This is what happens. The majority are wrong, and Ibn Hazm is wrong. Because the hadith, which is in Bukhari, is not the only hadith. The hadith has been narrated by Ma'mar. This hadith is narrated by Ma'mar as well, with a different narration. He says, the Prophet said, if it's a liquid, then throw it away. If it's something that is, what is not liquid,
solid,
you have to throw it, the mice, and anything around it. So, when the Prophet is asked the question, he was asked about butter and the mice. He definitely answered about the mouse, because he referred to it as it. Throw it and what's around it. But he didn't speak about the butter. He said, if it's a liquid, and we have to take the, we don't care about the question. We care about what the Prophet saying, his words, and we have to take them generally. So, it is the mice only, but it is any liquid. So if a mouse is found dead in any liquid, you have to throw it. But if a mice is found dead in a solid thing, you have to throw the mouse with anything around it. This is what the Prophet has said. As for the cat, for a pigeon, for a goat, it's fine. There is no, the Prophet didn't say it, and there is nothing that's logic. Okay, if something else falls, if something falls in my liquid, I have to throw it away. There is nothing that, oh, this is logic or no. Actually, if you look at it now, from what we know, from the what we know now, science, that the mice carry a disease, carry disease that other animals don't carry, and so it's not a wonder that if the Prophet, Allah who knows everything, knows these things before the scientists, has spoken about the mice falling into any liquid or into any solid thing. But yeah, who said that if a cat falls into a drink, I have to throw it away? Why? If the Prophet didn't say it, if the Prophet said it, we will have to take it. If he didn't say it, yeah, what's the problem with it? Who says that we you have to do it?
Sure, would it be wrong to do it?
What?
Wrong
throwing your property, throwing property, wasting property, because a cat has fallen in it. Now, you may not like to eat it; it's your business, but you have to dispose of it without throwing it. This is it will be haram to waste property. So you probably can't eat it. You can give it to someone else who can eat it. Yeah, you can even give it to animals, but it's haram to throw property just like that. You know that example?
There is, but I have been written.
You don't remember? Anything from anyone?
Sure. If you tying the camel.
Huh?
Tying the camel to say the cause of today.
Tying the camel how?
Tying the camel and then have tawakkul ala Allah.
Yeah, the hadith is da'if anyway.
Okay.
Tawakkul ala Allah is you have to do tawakkul ala Allah. The whole Quran, وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ, and all the religion speaks about تَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ doesn't mean that the Prophet has been asked about this. There is hadith sahih about this, meaning when he said that everybody of you, his place is known from Jannah or Hellfire, and then he said, shouldn't we just rely on that? He said, no. Work or do your deeds, and everybody will be he will be helped or
accompanied.
Yeah, to do what has been decreed to do. Yeah, but the Prophet didn't say anything about tying the camels or the sheep. Don't worry about that.
The fly falling into liquid.
Yeah. Are you going to Yeah, if beetle fall into their liquid, you better throw it away if you want. Yeah, what has to do with the fly? Even people who do qiyas didn't do qiyas here, don't worry. They just said if some people said the bee, if it's fallen into the drink, you should do it. But they didn't rely on qiyas here. They said a bee is called a fly, and their proof for that is hadith which is da'if, weak hadith, that says every fly is in hellfire except the bee. So that is why they say that the bee as well must be. They say its name is fly. The Prophet called it fly.
But that hadith
is ضعيف. No.
The one about the fly's wing.
Yeah, that hadith is صحيح. That hadith is in Bukhari.
Perhaps the scientists found out that they really have a wing.
It may be that they found. We don't know.
Scientists have done extensive research on the fly itself. They said one carries the cure.
Well, you have to see who said this thing. Sometimes some very very good Muslim who want to help the religion.
Yeah,
non-Muslim. Well, that's good then.
Yeah, but don't the hadith say itself? Mm.
It just I don't listen to this anymore because they come today with a story and they deny it the following day.
But the hadith says it.
Yeah, that's what I believe it. Huh?
No.
But I don't say the scientist has said. Huh? I don't care if the scientist has said it or not. Huh? It is true. Huh? One wing carries a disease and the other carries the
cure.
Huh? Mm-hmm. This is definitely. Huh? They found it or they didn't find it, doesn't make any change.
Sheikh, you narrated hadith about the camel.
The you find it in Musnad Ahmad, and it's narrated by someone called Muhammad bin Amr bin Alqama bin Waqqas. This is one narration, and there is another narration. I don't remember the man in it. Yeah, but it is ضعيف. It is according to the majority ضعيف. The muhaddithin don't look at this hadith to be sahih. Don't consider this hadith to be sahih. If there was for example, the majority considered to be sahih, or I will. Explain to you. I would not just say it's daif. I would say there is different opinions. So.
Sure. Is there like anything which has got a similar meaning?
What?
To tying the camel then having.
Well, I told you just hadith. Huh? The whole religion is about
depending on Allah
while you are doing what you are doing, what you are supposed to do.
But we have to use. And you saying like. When Rasulullah if he tied the camel.
He didn't tie any camel. We don't know that he tied or he didn't.
His friends.
Yeah, his companions.
Yeah, the companions. So we have to tie the, we have to lock the car.
No, we have to lock the car because this is. I don't have to lock the car. Huh? If I am living in a place where there is no thieves. I don't have to lock the car if my car is automated. If my car, for example, has automated system which recognizes the person who is sitting in it. Huh? So if someone sits in it, the doors get locked automatically. This is what we call, the Prophet has said, أنتم أعلموا بأمور دنياكم. You know how to protect your property. You understand? It has nothing to do with religion here. Huh? How to whether to put your car in a garage or you put it in. If there is police looking outside, I don't have to lock my car.
But when you say tawakkal Allah, you have to use logic. I mean, why tawakkal Allah? You have to use. You have to do your job and then Allah will do it.
Yeah, but I have to do my job, yeah. But what has this to do with Qiyas anyway? How this comes into Qiyas?
The camel and the camel.
Well, we say the hadith of the camel. First, before you do Qiyas, you have to prove the hadith to be sahih. That the Prophet has said something and then you do Qiyas on it. I told you, it has nothing, the hadith is daif. It has nothing to do with religion. How to protect your car is your business, because the Prophet told us that أنتم أعلموا بأمور دنياكم. You know your dunya better than me, than him. Hmm? We know how to protecting your property. It's not described in Quran. It's up to you. You know how to protect your, and you don't have to tie your camel if your camel is very intelligent. If your camel is intelligent and doesn't go to other people's property and start destroying their field, you don't have to tie it.
Can you tie Khudul Hidrakum Fampiru to Qiyas to do the seatbelt when you drive?
To?
الآية خذوا حذركم فانفروا
ثبات أو انفروا جميعا
خذوا حذركم you know like when you drive you know you take a precaution you
well خذوا حذركم why do you do قياس here خذوا حذركم be warned huh? So when you go to fight you go either individually or together but when you fight you have to be careful huh? You have to be careful here what didn't
instead of using the hadith
when you drive you have to be careful you have to be careful you don't have to be careful if you are in the desert you just have to be careful don't kill other people it's haram to kill other people we know that it's haram to if you are in motorway huh? What kind of just go 100 300 miles an hour if you want as long as there is no one to be killed yeah so why because killing other people is haram
and you're not breaking the law sir
Huh?
If there's a law as well, you have to watch the speed limits, otherwise you get.
Well, it's. Yeah, of course, you don't have to put yourself into trouble, but yeah. So, but this is not qiyas at all. Nobody will bring this example as qiyas. Bring something that.
The instrument.
The instrument.
The music hadith.
Yes.
The one who says.
Yeah, لا يكونن أقوام من أمتي يستحلون الحرى والحرير والخمر والمعازف. Yeah, what's in this?
The music in this time.
Yeah.
It's
if the hadith was صحيح, which is not. If the hadith was صحيح, then it says معازف, the instrument of the music. He didn't say. The instrument of the music of this time, so it will be any instrument of music of this time and the next time. But the hadith is da'if. The hadith is da'if according to Ibn Hajar. The hadith is not in Bukhari. The hadith is mentioned by Bukhari. It's not narrated by Bukhari. That's what Ibn Hajar accept and agree. That the hadith Bukhari narrated it. What we call mu'allaq hadith mu'allaq. He never said. Who narrated the hadith to him? This hadith is narrated from someone called Hisham ibn Ammar, who is not thiqa according to the majority. He is thiqa by some and da'if by some. Bukhari met him when he was old. Ibn Hajar agreed that this man was da'if. Yeah, there is someone who narrated this hadith along with him called Bishr ibn Bakr in Abu Dawud, but he never mentioned the ma'azif. So the word of ma'azif is out. And this hadith, there is a lot of talk about this hadith. But even if it was sahih, if it was sahih, then the hadith, what are you going to do qiyas of what? What on what? Ma'azif on ma'azif? We don't do qiyas something on itself. We do qiyas of something similar. You say the hadith, he said ma'azif. That the Prophet has said, mentioned ma'azif to be haram. Okay. And what are you going to make haram? Other ma'azif? Yeah, of course. If he mentioned ma'azif to be haram, every ma'azif will be haram. The one that he knew in his time and the one that comes after. Because it's general. The way the Prophet said, kullu muskirin khamr wa kullu khamrin haram. Every muskir is khamr. Every intoxication is alcohol and every alcohol is haram. This is not qiyas. He defined what is the intoxication and he said it's haram so anytime you find something that comes under this definition this is from Jawami' al-Kalim what the Prophet the eloquency of speech making short statement that covers everything that he wanted to talk about so that has nothing to do with qiyas if you have another example
So just sorry to go out there, but there is no dalil that music is haram.
There is no hadith that says music is haram. Music, word music, musiqa, in Arabic. You will never find a word with musiqa in Quran or Sunnah.
What do you say in the second ayah of the Surah Al-Rahman?
Yeah, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْتَرِي and amongst people وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْتَرِي لَهُوَ الْحَدِيثِ لِيُضِلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ amongst people those who buy the idol talk, to the idol talk. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ But there are among men those who purchase idol tales without knowledge to mislead from the path of Allah and throw ridicule. For such there will be a humiliating chastisement. To you see here, it's not there are among men who purchase idol tales, but with a condition, without knowledge, to mislead from the path of Allah. You see, idol tales in Arabic language is not music. The instruments don't speak, do they? The instruments don't speak. Tales is words, talk. I tell you what is idol talk. Idol talk when you tell someone, Allah has sent the book and has sent his messenger with the sunnah to explain the book. And you tell him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran, اتبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم, follow what has been revealed to you by your Lord. ولا تتبعوا من دونه أولياء. Don't follow. Awliya, don't follow other anything other than what Allah has said and the Prophet has said. And he will tell you, what do you do with this? What are you going to do with that? What are you? And he start giving you examples. That is the idol talk, to drive rather than follow what Allah has said. We give him examples to drive people away from his from the Quran and Sunnah. That is the idol talk that people are using. That
Sheikh, would you say like his poetry and things like this, then poetry
is
not anything to do with Quran and Sunnah?
Let me give you an example. When this ayah was revealed, Surah Luqman, unanimously Surah Luqman is in Mecca, was revealed in Mecca. Who will understand the Quran better than the Prophet? No one. Okay. The Prophet in Medina, listen to music. The only music available at the time. Aisha narrated in Bukhari that the Prophet was lying down in a corner of the house and girls playing tambourine in her place. And Abu Bakr came and shouted at them. The Prophet said, leave them. For every nation there is Eid, and this is our Eid. This is our festival. Okay. Another place. Mu'awidh, Rubay' bint Mu'awidh, said, the Prophet, Yazid bin Suhan, he said he came to see Rubay' bint Mu'awidh. She is a companion of the Prophet. He sat in front of her. She said, the Prophet, while coming, it was the day of Ashura, and he found some girls playing tambourine, playing music, singing. And he told her that he complained. He didn't like what he saw. He complained that people are playing music and this is idol. He probably heard about the idol talk and... So she said, the Prophet was sitting in front of me, or next to me, the way you are sitting next to me, and girls playing music and singing. They were mentioning our grandfather, their grandfathers. They were like praising the people who died in Jahiliyyah, from amongst the Aus of Khazraj, the tribes of Ansar, until one of the girls said, وَفِينَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي غَدٍ. Amongst us, there is a prophet, the prophet of Allah, that knows what will happen tomorrow. The prophet told her, leave that and go back to what you are saying. You see, this is an order. Is singing Munkar? The Prophet tell her, go back to Munkar? No way. When he heard the Munkar, he said, leave it. When he heard the idol talk, when he heard amongst us there is a Prophet who knows this is idol talk, he said, stop it and go back to, it's fine. Mention your grandfathers, your mention.
So I have a question, sorry. If someone plays a guitar, let's say for example, according to the people, this is halal, he's going to get hasana or sayyah?
He will not get to get neither hasana neither sayyah. He will get probably sayyah if the prayer is has started and he is playing and leave the prayer. He will get to get hasana if he is trying to do what the Prophet used to do. For example, get his children to play for some time. Or for there was no guitar, and because there was no guitar and the Prophet didn't mention it, we are not allowed. All religion, the whole religion is about making haram and halal. It's not a problem that someone listen to music. It's a problem that someone make haram and halal without permission from Allah. This is, just listen to these verses here before you make your decision about halal and haram. After the Prophet has, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this ayah about the Jewish people, the Jewish people made a lot of things haram. Why? To get closer to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ هَادُوا, for those who followed the Jewish law, we forbade every animal with undivided hoof, and we forbade them the fat of the ox and the sheep, except what adheres to their backs or their entrails or is mixed up with the bone. This is in recompense of their willful disobedience, for we are true in our ordinance. Yeah? See what he says afterwards. Those who give partners to Allah will say, if Allah had wished, we should not have given partners to Him, nor would our fathers, nor should we have had any forbidden thing. They shouldn't have done forbidding things. This is what Allah doesn't like, that people may forbid things. So did their ancestors argue falsely until they tested of our wrath. Say, have you any certain knowledge? If so, produce it before us. If anyone says, see, this is haram, don't tell me, is it good or bad? It is good. Good and bad, people differ in it. Everybody, you were considered to be good. Everybody considered the music to be good until he heard the Sheikh of Saudi. Yeah, and he heard that it's haram, then he started thinking it's haram. I am someone who doesn't like music. From where I came, we don't play music too much, and we consider it to be a woman thing. However, when you say haram, how did you know? It's known like this? No, it's not known like this. It's fitra? Why? The Prophet, when he was listening, when he was there next to Aisha, he was not on fitra? From the ayah? Why? The Prophet didn't know this ayah? It was revealed before. You can't say this, what he has done here is mansukh. About new instruments? So, you are telling me that the ayah was revealed. The instruments that were there were not forbidden. The ayah was revealed about the instruments of the music. It never forbade the instruments that were available. It forbade the instruments that will come later. Yes.
So you're doing qiyas now?
What's qiyas?
The instruments in that time and the instruments in this time.
No, I'm not doing any qiyas. Halal is halal. Is the haram, if I say something is haram, you see, the instruments that were there were halal because Allah never forbade them. And the instruments that there is today are halal because Allah never forbade them. And everything is halal until Allah forbid it. This is not qiyas. in any way, nobody will call this qiyas. You are wrong.
لا. أفنتين لا من الناس.
من يشتري له الحديث.
Did some of the Sahaba say that?
Yes, Ibn Mas'ud and Ibn Abbas, and the other Sahaba have read this ayah. Like Aisha, like Rubayya bint Muawwidh, like Abu Mas'ud, and others, Ja'far, Abdullah bin Ja'far, like Muawiyah bin Abi Sufyan, and they didn't understand what Ibn Mas'ud has understood. And if someone must insist that Ibn Mas'ud and Ibn Abbas get it right every time, we will have to give them a list of what Ibn Mas'ud and Ibn Abbas has said. If they agree about all what Ibn Mas'ud and Abdullah bin Abbas has said, then we say it's fine. You agree with him, but we don't agree with everything that Ibn Mas'ud has said. Ibn Mas'ud has denied some things that are clear in Quran and Sunnah. He has denied tayammum. He has denied that قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ are from Quran. He has denied many things. Ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Abbas has said that the many things in Quran that people don't agree with him. So now, if you say Ibn Abbas never got it wrong, it's fine. You have to follow Ibn Abbas all the time. I don't say that. I say whatever Ibn Abbas says, if he has proof, then he is trustworthy. Ibn Abbas doesn't lie. Ibn Mas'ud doesn't lie. If they say the Prophet has said, we have to trust them. If they say it here, the Prophet has said it, we will take it. But this is just an opinion. And an opinion, we don't have to take, it's not only we don't have to take that opinion, we have to reject any opinion that it is not supported by Quran and Sunnah.
Some can argue maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired Ibn Mas'ud.
No. we don't. Nobody is inspired. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ الرُّسُلِ. So there will be no argument to be for people after the prophets. Allah will has sent us a prophet. You see, if someone dies not knowing Ibn Mas'ud, is still fine.
No, Ibn Abbas.
Yeah.
He was supposed to have the best understanding of the Quran.
I told you the answer for that. If Ibn who said that Ibn Abbas will understand every single ayah and hadith better than anybody else? Who said this? Where did you get it? Did the Prophet say it?
Did the Prophet make a dua for Ibn Abbas to say he will be like the best that?
No, he never said that he will be the best. The Prophet said, Allahumma allimhu al-kitab. Oh Allah, teach him the book. Do you think Anas ibn Malik said, the Prophet came to, we invited the Prophet, he went to them, to their place. He was fasting. When he got there, the Prophet was asked, when he got to the place of Ibn Mas'ud of Anas, the Prophet was fasting. So he refused to eat first. The mother of Anas told the Prophet, Anas is your servant. Make dua for him. He said, the Prophet said, Allahumma kathir walad malahu wa waladahu, Allah make his wealth abundant and his children and many other dua. And he didn't leave any good thing from dunya or akhirah except he made dua for me. That we should be acknowledged as well. What about the other Sahaba? Do you think that the Prophet, these people were living with the Prophet? And some, most of them, they do him favors, some give him a gift, some, what the Prophet will, what kind of dua he will make for them? The same dua that he made to Ibn Abbas. So really, you won't find here any, that Ibn Abbas, yeah, he has knowledge. We can see the effect of that dua in Ibn Abbas. But never the Prophet said, never the Prophet said that Ibn Abbas will know everything. Take the hadith of Ibn Abbas, the Prophet made a dua. But the Prophet had an inspiration that if someone in this ummah would be inspired, that will be Umar ibn Khattab. So that is the truth, this is inspiration. That the Prophet has given him the leftover of his drink. And he said, it's knowledge. That is something that happened. So Ibn Umar is, Umar ibn Khattab is knowledgeable. Ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Abbas is a dua. A dua from the Prophet. Who is more likely to be answered? Who is the person who is more likely that his dua will be answered? The Prophet. Is every dua that the Prophet has done guaranteed to be answered fully? The Prophet said, for every hadith narrated by Bukhari and Muslim from Abu Huraira, for every Prophet, there is one dua that is answered. And I have hidden my dua to the day of judgment. The day that definitely will be answered, 100%, the Prophet has hidden this dua to the day of judgment. Every other dua, it can be answered, it can be not. 90%, 70%, 50%.
So if they say it was answered.
Huh?
What if you say it?
Well, he never said that it was answered. I told you we can see the effect of the Prophet's dua on Ibn Abbas. He was one of the most knowledgeable Sahaba. Nobody can say or claim that he has the knowledge that Ibn Abbas had. However, we can see people who just all the time say Ibn Abbas, Ibn Abbas, they will go and contradict him when he is right. And you have many examples. I can give you many examples. Examples where Ibn Abbas has said things that nobody will agree. It's not that he didn't know the dalil. He knew the proof. Ibn Abbas was told about the temporary marriage. He was told by Ali ibn Abi Talib, who told him, you are a man, you are of pride, that has pride. He told him that the Prophet has forbidden the temporary marriage, and he refused. He refused until he died. He heard it from from Ali ibn Abi Talib. He had heard it from Abdullah ibn Zubayr, until Abdullah ibn Zubayr threatened him that he will stone him to death if he does it. We don't say anything, but his opinion, that what he thought was right. But if you say he doesn't make, we should take everything he says without going back to the Prophet, take this.
People always use the saying of Ibn Abbas about those who don't know what Allah has revealed. The ayah.
Yeah.
Those who do not rule by what Allah has revealed.
Yes.
They are kafirs. People say, yeah. Ibn Abbas said,
Yeah.
It's not the kufr you're thinking of.
If Ibn Abbas had said it, then it won't be good enough, because we need something from the Prophet to change the meaning of word. But Ibn Abbas didn't say it. This hadith is narrated by many people. The man they relied on to make this hadith sahih is called Hisham bin Hujair. Assalamu alaikum. Hisham bin Hujair, who narrated it from Abdullah bin Tawus, from his father, from Abdullah bin Abbas, that he read this ayah, and then he said this is kufr duna kufr. Hisham bin Hujair, even though Bukhari narrated some hadith from him, but he never rely on him. He will not bring any hadith from Hisham bin Hujair unless he is supported by someone else, because he considers him to be weak. However, the trustworthy people have narrated this hadith from Abdullah bin Tawus, and they made it the saying of Abdullah bin Tawus rather than the saying of Ibn Abbas. And if Ibn Abbas has said it, then there are other Sahaba who contradicted him. Jabir bin Abdullah, when he was told, you see these people, you hear this argument a lot from some people. They say, this ayah is in the kafirs. You hear this a lot from the Salafis today. When they say, oh, this ayat about وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ, this is all about the kafirs, it's not about the Muslims, about the Jewish. And what did Jabir bin Abdullah say with isnad, which is not really strong, but it's similar to the one they use, so they have to take it. It says, he said, نِعْمَ الْإِخْوَةُ لَكُمْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ, the best brothers to you are Bani Israel. إِنْ كَانَ خَيْرًا قُلْتُمْ لَهُمْ وَلَنَا وَإِنْ كَانَ شُرًّا قُلْتُمْ عَلَيْهِمْ لَا عَلَيْنَا. So if it's good, when Allah says, for example, if the Jewish people do this, Allah will reward them with this, you will say, oh, this is for them and for us. But when he say, if they do this, they will punish this way, they will say, no, this is for Bani Israel, not for us. So Jabir bin Abdullah said this, huh? So why do you take what Ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Abbas has said? Jabir bin Abdullah is a Sahabi. Take everything then. The other thing, these people who say this, and today is only the Salafis who argue about this, they go about the ayah that says about people worshipping the idols, the people who used to worship Lati wal Uzza and Manat, and they use it against people who go to the graves. Why don't they say there was no people at the time of the Prophet, Muslim people, worshipping idols? So all the ayat about worshipping idols is about people who worship idols, about the mushrikeen of Quraysh and the other Arabs who didn't believe in the Prophet, who didn't call themselves Muslims. Why do they use this ayat against the Muslims today who go to the graves? This is contradiction. They contradict themselves here. Okay, we went out of the subject of qiyas. I was going to talk about this hadith. I didn't mention before, yes.
You say the Salaf is saying, Salaf is not another saying that. You claim that the Salaf is saying about وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ. Who's saying that?
I think everybody here agree with me.
I don't agree.
With respect, who's
this guy to agree or not agree?
Who?
With respect to these guys and with respect to you.
Yeah.
So who's the guy to judge the Salafi or the Ummah by
you? We're not judging the Ummah, we're judging the Salafis.
The Salafis is the Ummah.
A'udhu billah. The Salafi is a bid'ah. Salafis is a bid'ah.
Who's Salafis you mean?
The Salafi scholars.
I mean the Salafis, I mean the people who follow this group, new group, huh? Yeah. That they went out of the Ummah,
yeah.
And gave themselves a name,
yeah.
Which is not in Quran and Sunnah.
Yeah.
I mean this people who came from Saudi and these are the Salafis.
You are wrong,
I think. Yeah, so you are Salafi?
Alhamdulillah.
You are Salafi.
Everyone is Salafi.
I am not.
We refer.
No, I am not.
We refer our understanding to the Quran to the Salaf.
Okay.
This is bid'ah, yeah, to say I'm Salafi, I'm not.
Jazakallah khair. That's what I'm talking about.
To claim that the Salafi saying that, you give something. Yeah. You're saying that they never say that, for example. That's وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. The Ash'ari and the Sufi, they're saying that. And I don't know, the Zahir maybe, they're saying that.
What?
وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. They mean
the Jew and the Christian.
The Salafi, they mean the Muslim and the Kuffar as well.
Okay.
Whoever don't, I don't know what's the translator. The rule, the Ummah, not
according
to the Quran Sharia,
he's
kafir, definitely.
Jazakallah khair. Then you have no different. So the Salafis, I will take it from you.
Yeah.
That the Salafis this don't say it. Alhamdulillah.
This is the Imam Muhammad Abdul Wahhab he's saying.
And yeah.
This is the Imam Ibn Taymiyyah he's saying.
Yeah, but this is not what today's. I don't consider Ibn Taymiyyah to be a Salafi.
Yeah.
Huh? I don't consider Ibn Taymiyyah to be a Salafi. I don't consider Ibn Baz to be a Salafi. Because he said that you shouldn't call yourself. Yeah, but I am talking about the Salafi, the Saudi agents in London, the Madkhalis and Halabis and stuff. So this is the people who insist on calling themselves Salafis. And I'm sure that the people who are here know that these people say that what I said. So if you are denying that, It's up to you. Huh?
This is Quran, okay. This is Quran. This is Quran. It's Quran saying that we have to accept and we have to.
Yeah, but yeah, I agree. But some people don't, and we are mentioning them.
every school, like suppose there's Salafi and there's Salafi school, yes. For example. Every school you find some people. You didn't say, for example, in the Salafi school or some of the Salafi. You say all the Salafi.
No, the Salafi,
yeah.
The Salafi that we refer to are known. Huh?
Yeah.
I told you, Ibn Taymiyyah was not Salafi. Ibn Baz was not Salafi. Yeah. Hmm? He denies that.
Yeah.
Even Al-Fawzan and these people, huh?
Yeah.
They don't consider themselves to be Salafis.
Yeah.
Salafi is a group that has been created now. People, yeah. And they normally rely on this Madkhali and, I don't know, Halabi and... they claim to follow the madhab of Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, but actually they change and twist the words of Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab. Wherever they started saying that you can't understand the Quran and Sunnah, we have to go to the ulama, and now they say no, you can't understand Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, you can't understand the ulama, we have to go to the agents of Saudi to explain it to us and to twist it. So this is the people I mentioned, and these people here definitely know that these people say, I have read it in their books, I have read it in their newspapers, and all why they say this, it's just because they work for the governments and they want people to follow the governments, what the governments are saying. So I am right, JazakAllah khair. So now, we go back to the Qiyas. There is hadith narrated that you have heard about, probably, that the Ummah will be divided into 73 sects. And this hadith is narrated by, has many chain of narrators. Narrated by Muawiyah, reported to be narrated by Muawiyah, Anas bin Malik, Abu Huraira, Auf bin Malik. Some people say this hadith is sahih. This hadith is da'if. Like if you take every chain of narrators, every single chain, it's da'if. When they make it sahih is by putting all the chain of narrators together. Now, The strongest chain of narrators here of this hadith is the hadith that's narrated by Nu'aym bin Hammad. Nu'aym bin Hammad is the Shaykh of Bukhari. And it says the Ummah will be divided into 73 sects. All of them, no, into 73 sects. The most of them, the most who is in fitna is the sect that will do qiyas and make halal haram and haram halal. Now this hadith, I don't consider this hadith to be da'if because of Nu'aym bin Hammad. Nu'aym bin Hammad, there is two different opinions of it about him. Now this hadith, if this chain of narrators put any other hadith to it, they will say hadith sahih. The majority will say this hadith is sahih. When it came to this hadith, they said no, this is a mistake. Nu'aym bin Hammad, bin Ma'in, who is very knowledgeable in hadith definitely, and his what he says should be taken into consideration and looked at. We rely on these people when we decide hadith is sahih or not sahih. Was asked about this hadith. He was asked about this hadith. He said it's invalid. So the student asked him, what about Nu'aym bin Hammad? He said he's trustworthy. He said, how can a trustworthy person narrate invalid hadith? He said it's a mistake.
Who says invalid?
Nu'aym bin Ibn Ma'in. So he said it's a mistake. Now we have from today people, like Ahmed Shakir, like Albani, they always don't accept. They say if a muhaddith, no matter how big he is, Bukhari or Ahmed bin Hanbal or Ibn Ma'in, if they want to take hadith which is narrated by trustworthy and say this hadith is invalid, they have to prove it. Their knowledge is not enough. Just because they are big and known in hadith, they shouldn't just come to hadith sahih and make it invalid. They have to say why and explain something. They have to show it. But when it came to this hadith, they agreed. Even though Ibn Ma'in himself can't say why this hadith is daif. Some people, about this issue of qiyas, some people, if the Prophet came to them and said qiyas is invalid, do we still say no, it's valid? Ibn al-Qayyim in his book, the I'lam al-Muwaqqi'in, the book of Usul al-Fiqh, he is for Qiyas. He narrates this hadith about the most sect who is in fitna, is the sect that falls in Qiyas. What does he say about this hadith? Now, if he considers this hadith to be da'if, it will be fine. You say this hadith is sahih.
Who said that,
Shaykh? Ibn al-Qayyim. Well, may Allah forgive Ibn al-Qayyim. Ibn al-Qayyim is a human being after all. What does he say about this? He said the Prophet didn't mean the qiyas that we do. He meant the wrong qiyas. He considered first the hadith to be sahih, and then he say the Prophet didn't mean the qiyas that we are doing, the qiyas that people, the wrong qiyas. What if someone says, oh, the Prophet didn't mean the idols, to destroy the idols, he meant Allati wal-Uzza, the other idols that are not worshipped, it's fine. What if someone said the alcohol, the Prophet didn't mean any alcohol, he just meant the alcohol of grapes and dates. That's what they had at the time. This qiyas is really a fitna. It's something that was brought to the religion that Allah has not given permission to anyone to use. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had never given permission to anyone to make halal haram and haram halal. The haram is what Allah has made haram. The halal is what Allah has made halal.
So what if, about istihsan?
Istihsan is, if you go to istihsan, what did Shafi'i? Shafi'i has written a full, what we say, risala. He has statement about the people who do istihsan. And he said in his book, when he speaks about istihsan, he said, whoever does istihsan, he has brought new religion, sharia. His statement about istihsan was very strong. He's one of his very respected, known students is called Ibrahim bin Jabir. He said he was Shafi'i. He was Shafi'i for a long time. He said, I looked carefully to the statement of Shafi'i in denying istihsan. And then I found that the same argument could be used against the people who do qiyas. It's the same. He said it's leading the same way. And therefore, he decided to leave qiyas. And he became someone who doesn't do qiyas, he just follow Quran and Sunnah. But istihsan is denied by many. The istihsan is only the ahnaf to istihsan. No other madhab. Even though they use it, but everybody considers it to be wrong. In the usul generally, in the rules of understanding, the Malikis, the Shafi'is, the Hanbalis consider istihsan to be wrong. it's sure that some Hanbalis the Hanbalis actually are the farthest people from Istihsan and from Qiyas generally. Because Ahmed ibn Hanbal denied Qiyas as well. Yes.
The hadith by Bukhari's teacher, where is that? Where is that
hadith? The hadith about Qiyas.
About the Qiyas one, yeah.
Yeah, you find it in Musnad Ahmed. And you find it in many books. Yeah.
So did Bukhari and his teacher use Qiyas?
Bukhari has full chapter, Kitab al-I'tisam. Kitab al-I'tisam. The Quran, holding fast to the Quran and Sunnah. You will find it in the last book of his, in English, in the 9th yeah. volume. He speaks about people, how the Prophet, some of the chapters he mentioned there, how the Prophet used to wait when he was asked about something that he doesn't know and don't answer according to Qiyas. How the Prophet used to give an example similar to mentioned in known and compare it to a known example rather than doing known example. So both known from Sharia, just to compare them together to explain to the person rather than doing Qiyas.
Check page 307 of chapter.
So if there is no Qiyas, means there is no Ijtihad.
Well, ijtihad, there is ijtihad. Ijtihad, everybody is supposed to do ijtihad. This is ijtihad. Ijtihad is ijtihad, what people call ijtihad and istinbat. Is this. Is to go and learn Quran and Sunnah. This is ijtihad. Is to spend time learning Quran and Sunnah to find the truth.
No, sometimes there is a new rule, sometimes comes, for example, text, sometimes haram, but there is some...
Well, everybody says this, but they never bring any proof, they never bring any example.
Probably there is no proof, for example, this clear from the Quran.
No, everything is clear. Tilka ayatul kitab al-mubin. Tilka ayatul kitab al-mubin. Tibiyana likulli shay' wa anzalna ilayka al-dhikra litubayyana lin-nasi. To clarify, clear. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. Do you want me to believe him or to believe you?
It's up to you.
It's up to me. Stop it, just think about it.
Stop it, the question
you I have to believe what Allah said. Tilka ayatul kitab al-mubin.
Yeah, stop it, the question you asked me. Yeah. To believe you or to believe? This yeah. is, make it from that question.
The thing is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that the Quran is clear. And that the Quran came, He sent the Quran to clarify everything. So everything is clear in Quran and Sunnah. And when you tell me something new that is not in Quran and Sunnah, I have heard this. Something new. So what is the new?
In fact, there is a new. Especially life. In business, for example.
Yeah.
There are so many issues that come.
Yeah, if you go to the book of business in Bukhari and Muslim, you will find that anything that's in business, it is covered.
Something new, for example, abortion is haram.
Huh? Abortion is haram.
It's clear it's haram.
Yes.
But there is some conditions where they make it halal.
Where?
For example, in what happened in Bosnia.
Yeah.
Most of the scholars say it's okay. It's halal. Because
they are wrong. They are killing. وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ This is haram. Clear in the book of Allah.
But most in 1992, most of the scholars.
Yeah, the 1992, most of the people were wrong then.
Bad year.
They contradict Quran and Sunnah.
They say how to bring child to grow. Who is the woman?
Yeah, the Prophet should have told the woman who came and agreed and said that she committed zina. He should have told her to make abortion then. It was haram, child. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك
الله اكبر الله اكبر
الله اكبر الله اكبر